and we continue our parish faith mission as we did last week. We begin our prayer as people of faith, as we always do, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you always. Now I just invite you to be seated just for a brief moment. Good morning, welcome you all again this evening to our parish faith mission. Especially want to welcome all the children and young people and all the young families who join us again this evening. To welcome people who travel the distance to be with us here, and to welcome all the people of our own parish who are joining us again this evening. You obviously liked what you came for last week. I heard a lot of very favourable comments during the week. Lovely comments about Father Declan last week and his lovely tone of voice and his lovely way of speaking to us and the experience he brought to our parish mission. I heard brilliant comments about Declan last week, all during the week, Declan. You're there, you're in at number one, Declan. So you're doing very well. And I heard lovely comments too about all the people that came and all the gathering of people that we came, and the uplifting experience it was for people, and the hope it gave to people, the joy it gave to people to see a church full last week, as it is indeed tonight. So the mission, parish faith mission, is about faith, and as we know, it's about faith nourished, strengthened, cherished, celebrated, and lived. And we gather tonight to celebrate and give joy for that gift of faith. And that's a huge thing tonight, to celebrate and give thanks. It's obvious tonight that you do cherish your faith. It's obvious to me tonight that you want to grow and be strengthened in your faith tonight. And it's obvious to me tonight too that we want to listen to practical ways about how we can live out our faith. Father Declan spoke to us last week about faith. What's the point, he said? What's the point? What difference does faith make in our lives? And each person here this evening knows in your own hearts and in your own minds the difference that your faith brings to your life. The lift that your faith brings to you, the strength your faith brings to you, the joy your faith brings to you, the hope that your faith brings to you, the strength that your faith gives to you to face all of life's experiences. We've all brought our petitions to the parish faith mission, as we did last week. They continue to grow in the box there beside the shrine to Our Lady of Perpetual Help. We brought petitions from our children, from our schools, as we did last week. We brought petitions from individuals. We brought petitions from families. We prayed especially that Our Lady, who is the great intercessor for us, the one of perpetual help, who is always there to help us, will intercede for us with God and with our Lord and with our Lady. Tonight I'm privileged to welcome Father Peter McFerry, who has come to us tonight to speak to us about faith in action. Faith lived out in helping and supporting others, especially in their time of need. Myself and Father Peter have one thing in common. We both served in two areas. He served 6 years in the inner city and the last number of years in Ballymun. So we've that in common at least. Don't mind the mission of that. But Father Peter and myself is a priest of God. And as priests and as people, we try to give witness to our faith by David. And Father Peter's life is a living witness to Christ and to caring for the poor and the needy and disadvantaged. So I'm going to invite you now to stand as we begin our Psalms night with two more hymns, and we continue now with our opening hymn of our parish faith mission, As I Kneel Before You.
This is page 48.
Page 48.
I sing this in a very personal way to our Lady Mary of Fatima, so is it nobody else in the church? This is to her, and she hears very well.
Light will rise in the darkness, and your shadows become light new.
initiation.
Sick and in prison, and you never visited me.
then it will be their turn to ask, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty, a stranger or naked, sick or in prison, and did not come to your help? Then he will answer, I tell you solemnly, insofar as you neglected to do this to one of the least of these, you neglected to do it to me. And they will go away to eternal punishment, and the virtuous to eternal life. The Gospel of the Lord.
Laying down laws, telling people what they should do and what they shouldn't do.
3 million people came to listen to him in Rio and at his final mass. In Manila, 6 million people came to listen to him. And they're coming to Francis not to hear him laying down laws, but they're coming to listen to Francis because everything Pope Francis is doing and saying is revealing a God who cares, the God of compassion. And the God of the law and the God of compassion are incompatible. Jesus, in a lovely story in Mark chapter 3, healed a man with a withered hand, but he healed him on the Sabbath. And we're told at the end of the story, the religious leaders went away to try and find a way to destroy Jesus. The God of the law would not allow Jesus to heal on the Sabbath. But the God of compassion required Jesus to heal on the Sabbath. Again, I grew up believing that Jesus came to lay down, to tell us what the laws of God were that we were to observe. Now, I believe that Jesus had a mission statement. Jesus told us what he came to do. And that mission statement is in the Our Father, the prayer that we say thousands of times. And his mission statement is to be found, and Jesus said, told his followers to pray, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Jesus came to establish here on earth the kingdom of God as it exists in heaven. Now, what's the kingdom of God in heaven like? When we get to heaven, we're going to be infinitely happy. That means all our needs are going to be met. There are no unmet needs in the kingdom of God in heaven. And therefore, Jesus came to establish a community, which became the Christian community. Community in which people would live together in a way that everybody's needs would be met. And in the kingdom of God in heaven, no one is second class, no one is rejected, no one is made to feel unwanted, no one is marginalized. And Jesus came to establish here on earth that kingdom where nobody is rejected, nobody is unwanted. You know, we're all these children of God. Every single human being is a child of God. Jesus came so that what Jesus wanted was that we human beings could live together and that nobody would be hungry and not be given food. Nobody would be thirsty and not be given water. Nobody would be in prison and be rejected. Nobody would be naked and not be given clothes. Nobody would be sick and not be in hospital. Jesus came to show us how to live together as the family of God. Now, in a family of four children, the parents don't give three of the children a nice big steak for their dinner and give the fourth child a red jab. In a family, whatever food is available, everybody shares. And yet, in the family of God, 1 billion people on our planet go to bed hungry every night. And every one of those 1 billion people is God's beloved child. No parent wants to see their child go to bed hungry every night. And God doesn't want to see God's children going to bed hungry every night. And in a family of four children, the parents don't give three of the children a nice warm bed for the night and tell the fourth child to sleep outside in the back garden. Now, whatever rooms are available, the whole family shares. And yet, in the family of God, in the family of God, in every city of our world, there are people sleeping on the streets. And every one of those people sleeping on the streets is God's beloved child. No parent wants to see their child sleeping on the streets. God does not want God's children sleeping on the streets. So Jesus came to show us how to
caring for each other, reaching out to each other, meeting each other's needs, caring and sharing, respecting each other, valuing each other. What unites us as Christians is not that we obey certain laws. What unites us as Christians is that we share Jesus' dream. The dream of the human race living together as the family of God. And so we commit ourselves as Christians, as the followers of Jesus, to building a world of justice and peace and equality. Young people sometimes say to me, how do you know there's a God? And I say, I don't tell you how to know there's a God. Imagine somebody sitting at a riverside on a lovely sunny day enjoying themselves. And there's a little child playing on the riverbank beside them. And the child falls into the river. And the man at the side of the river jumps in, pulls the child out, and saves the child's life. Now what will the parents of that child? Well, the first thing to do, of course, is go to the hospital or wherever and reassure themselves that their child is all right. But what's the next thing they will do? The next thing they will do is they will want to find that man. They will want to find him to thank him for what he has done for their child. And so I say to young people, do you want to know if there is a God? No point looking up into the sky. Look around you. Look around at the suffering and the distress of so many people. Reach out and take some of that suffering and some of that distress off their shoulders. And what will God do? God will want to find you. God will want to find you to thank you for what you have done for God's child. And when God finds you, then you will meet God. Then you will know that God exists. I said to young people, you will not find God in your churches. You will not encounter God in your prayers and in your hymns unless you first find God and encounter God in the needs, the suffering, and the distress of those around you. That's where you find God. You know, the poor offer us the greatest gift that anyone can offer us. The poor invite us to open our hearts to include them in our love. And if we open our hearts to include them in our love, then we become more loving persons. And therefore we become more like God. And no greater gift can anyone offer us than the gift of becoming more like God. Jesus asks us to reach out to the children of God who are suffering. And for every one of those, Jesus promises that we will be given the kingdom of God. Now, when we look at the world and we look at the suffering in the world, we look at the refugee problem, and we look at the Syrian war, and we look at Yemen, and we look at Somalia, we ask ourselves, what can I do? What can I do to relieve the suffering in the world? And so I finish with the story of the starfish. There was these starfish, thousands of them, stranded up on a beach by a high tide. And the tide had gone out, and the starfish were on the beach there, and they were dying in the sun. As a little child was walking along, and he was picking up that starfish and throwing it back into the water. And then he'd move along and he'd pick up another starfish and throw it into the water. And a man came along and he said to the child, what are you doing? And the child said, I'm throwing the starfish into the water. And the man said, but there are thousands and thousands of starfish on this beach. What difference do you think you can make? And the child picked up another starfish and threw it into the water, and he said, well, I'm making a difference to that starfish.
prayers, prayers for children, teenagers, young people, prayers for our spouses, prayers for aunts and uncles and cousins and extended family, prayers for all who are ill in hospital and at home, in mind, in body, in soul and spirit, prayers for the unemployed and those seeking jobs, prayers for those with addictions, they will be healed. Prayers for the bereaved, the sad, the lonely. Prayers for our family members who died. And prayers too for our own community. And through sharing in the parish mission, we will grow together in friendship, in care, in support, in a spirit of helpfulness to each other. And prayers too for our wider world, for peace in the wider world, for peace in our homes and with our neighbours, continued peace in our own country. That the gift of life will always be valued and respected and cared for. And especially we offer tonight prayers for the Chew family in our neighbouring parish of Summerhill, as they mourn the loss of Colin, Reverend Owen and Anne, Thomas and Lorraine and Yvonne, and remember especially Colin, who's died as a result of a tragic road accident. And we also remember the Prendergast family of Johnston Road, especially Jim, who was originally from our parish and now lives in Mullingar, as he mourns the loss of his wife, Doreen. We pray for a moment for each our own intentions, the intentions of our minds and our hearts this evening. Turn to page 12 in our Medina book as we pray for prayers of praise and intercession. The response to each of the prayers is, Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
Let us pray.
and in some way helping to create and make our parish community and the world and the whole world a little bit better. So I think just to give you Declan and Martin. Thank you.